Happy Sabbath. Good morning to each one of you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. It is a good morning.
Amen.
And God has done much for us, and we can be thankful for much. The title of our message today seems a little strange. Is the man of sin the man of sin? Well, he must be the man of sin. That's why we call him the man of sin. Or he wouldn't be the man of sin. But we're going to find out that maybe not everyone's so convinced. In Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 through 12, God has given to us as a people a very special message. Let's turn there and just read a few of the verses quickly as we begin. Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14, verse 6, first angel's message. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred, tongue, and people. Now, since the days of Adam, the gospel has been preached, right? We don't have to wait for Jesus. The gospel was preached before, right? And even Adam preached the gospel. He received the gospel about that there was going to be a Redeemer coming. He received the good news that that there would be enmity between man and the serpent. And he shared that with his children.
Yeah.
And he had a good child, Abel, who understood that and believed the gospel.
Amen.
But now we come to verse 7. This angel says with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water." Now there's an interesting message here. He says, the hour of his judgment is come. Now, is come is what?
Present tense,
right? Now, the Apostle Paul, he spoke about a judgment to come. Remember, he spoke about temperance, righteousness, and judgment future to come. And as you study through this, as you study through the history of this message, you find that this message was never preached until about the middle or the early part of the 19th century. You look through historical groups of people, the Lutherans, those who followed Luther, and the Calvinists that became the Presbyterians, and all these different groups, and they all focused on different portions of Scripture and sometimes as much of the Scripture as they could, but you don't ever find any group of people ever preaching this message prior to that time. Do you know why? Because, friends, its time had not come yet.
Amen.
The hour of his judgment had not come yet. We know prophetically, according to the book of Daniel, chapter 8, verse 14, and other verses, as we put all this together, that the hour of God's judgment began on October 22 of 1844.
Amen.
And so prior to that time, this message really couldn't have been preached. And God didn't send the angels, he didn't send his spirit to impress people to start preaching this until just before that time to announce that this was getting ready to happen. We know that a man by the name of William Miller, around 1833, began to preach about this great message. And others followed him, Joseph Wolfe and others. And they were preaching about this judgment hour's message. But they didn't understand the message fully. They thought that the earth was the sanctuary, was going to be cleansed in Daniel 8:14.
Mm-hmm.
And so when that didn't happen, and they thought that by being cleansed that man was going to be destroyed by fire and renewed, they realized something was wrong. But they looked at the timelines and they realized the timelines were right. They had the timeline right. But some event must be wrong. And as they studied, they realized that there was no scripture anywhere that said that the sanctuary was the earth, or the earth was a sanctuary. But they did find out that there's a great sanctuary in heaven, and this is the sanctuary that it's speaking about in Daniel 8:14. This is the sanctuary where the hour of God's judgment is come now, is going to occur from Revelation chapter 14, verse 7. But in Revelation chapter 14, verse 8 now, it says Babylon is fallen. A very simple message. That great city, because she hath made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. This Babylon primarily represents the Protestant churches who had a moral fall when they rejected the first angel's message just prior to 1844. These were churches that God wanted to do something with. But they rejected the message. And remember, these churches as a group, as a whole, they never accepted the Sabbath truth. They never accepted the truth about God. They always believed in the Catholic Sunday. Most all of them believed in the Catholic Trinity. Most all of them believed in the Catholic doctrine of the immortal soul, which is actually a pagan doctrine, not just a Catholic doctrine. And so God said, you know, these churches are fallen now. They're fallen. And in fact, they're not only fallen, but they're on their way back to Rome exceedingly fast, and even faster today than at that time. And so God had to have a response to all this. And it is in the three angels' messages. The hour of his judgment, Babylon has fallen, and then warning against the worship of the beast and his image and accepting his mark. This is part of God's plan. Daniel prophesied that a power would come up that would try to trample down the ministry of Christ in heaven. It would set up a system of confession to priests. Now, the Bible says that there's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, 1 Timothy 2:5, right?
Yes.
But instead of having one man as a mediator, the Catholic Church says we'll have many men as mediator. They'll call them the priests. And instead of confessing your sins to God through Christ, you confess your sins to the priest. The priest might give you some penance to do, and then he will say, ego tu absolvo, which is Latin for I forgive you. But of course, he can't forgive anyone. No man can forgive anyone's sins, friends. Amen. Only the man Christ Jesus. This system would deny the efficacy of the death of Jesus upon the cross, and in its place institute the Mass, where Jesus is said to be sacrificed over and over and over again. But the Bible says Jesus died once.
Amen.
The papacy tried to change God's times and laws, including the fourth commandment to Sunday, the removal of the second commandment, and the most serious misinterpretation of the first commandment possible. And because of this, the Bible calls this beast power the man of sin. Why is he called the man of sin? Well, before we answer that, maybe we need to understand a little bit more about sin. I'm going to ask you a question. It's not so hard, but a lot of people have trouble with it. And that is, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Right?
Chicken.
You know, we know as creationists, the chicken came first, right? That's given. That's very easy to understand because we have Bible texts. We have Bible evidence that tells us this is so. If you were to ask Richard Dawkins, for instance, he would have a hard time telling you which came first, the chicken or egg, because this man believes in evolution. He wrote a book called The God Delusion. And Dawkins contends that the supernatural creator almost certainly does not exist and that religious faith is a delusion. He calls it a fixed false belief. So he wouldn't know. We couldn't depend upon him for an answer. But what we want to do today is we don't want to look at theories. We want to look at realities. Now, to some people, sin is defined as a broken relationship. And this broken relationship leads to law-breaking or breaking of the law of God. Now, I'm going to quote a few people here today. I'm going to put their names on the screen. And the reason I do this is because you should know. But not only that, these people teach these things. They openly publish these things. They teach and profess these things openly. They shouldn't mind a little free advertisement, right? Nothing offending here. But this is from Norman Golly, who is perhaps the leading theologian in the Seventh-day Adventist Church today. He's just finished the fourth volume of a long series on systematic theology. And it's called The Church in Last Days. Interesting. But he says this. And this is from his first volume, Systematic Theology, Creation, Christ, Salvation. This is from pages 131 and 132, and I'll read these now. The tempter made himself appear more interested in Eve's future than her creator. It worked and led to the fall of the human race. Doubting God caused Eve to disobey him, and a broken relationship led to lawbreaking. A broken relationship led to lawbreaking. Now, before you go too far, remember in our Sabbath school class, we looked at a formula, and it really looked good, it sounded good, just keep that in mind. We're going to go on. Such lawbreaking or sin has a number of levels that lie behind the external act. At its deepest level, sin is a broken relationship with a relational trinity. The broken relationship caused the posterity of Adam to be born sinners, needing a Savior as soon as they enter the world. And again, this is from Norman Golly, Systematic Theology, Creation, Christ, and Salvation, pages 131 through 132. Now, notice it's interesting that his concept of sin is based first and foremost in the idea that there's a Trinity doctrine. And if you don't have a Trinity doctrine, you can't have the same kind of understanding that he has. That's interesting. But now, on a basis of logic or philosophy, this might seem plausible. It's a sad thing today, but in many seminaries, the students don't go in and study the Bible. If you remember at camp meeting time, Pastor David Sims was here, and he was telling about his time in the seminary. And he said he only had one biblical class that he ever studied the Bible from. In the time he was there, only one class they actually studied the Bible. He said all the other time they were studying Greek mythology, philosophy, anything but the Bible. Well, friends, I'm not interested in something that seems logical or something that seems like good philosophy that even might seem plausible. But friends, if an idea is not based upon the Bible, but rather springs from the concept of the Trinity, a non-biblical theory, and this Trinity is said to be a relationship God, I don't want anything to do with it. But the issue is not what does philosophy say, but what does the Bible say. Now, the Greek word that we translate sin in the New Testament is hamartia. And I just want to show you a few places where it's defined or how it's expressed in the New Testament. This word in its literal sense means to miss the mark. But let us notice what it means. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, again, we're not turning to Greek mythology, we're not turning to philosophy, we're not turning even to logic, we're just going to turn to the Bible. Is that fair enough? We want to turn to the Bible, right? 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. 1 John 3, 4. The sin, he says, is transgression of the law. Now, if I was to ask you to define an automobile for me, if you said, well, I have a Ford Escort, or I have a Dodge Ram truck, or whatever you might have, that doesn't define an automobile for me. It may give me an example of one. It may give me an illustration of one, but it doesn't define. But here we have not just simply something written down like, well, murder is sin, thievery is sin, adultery is sin. Those all are sins, by the way. But here is not simply an example or an illustration, but here's the definition of sin. And the definition is that sin is the transgression of the law. Now you might be thinking, well, that's really good, Alan, but the problem is it doesn't tell us what law is talking about, because in the Bible there's a lot of laws. There's, of course, the Ten Commandment law, right? But there were the ceremonial laws, there were health laws, a lot of different kind of laws. But let's notice what the Bible says, okay? Romans chapter 7. So let's turn over to Romans 7 now. Romans 7 and verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law, for I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Now what law says thou shalt not covet? The Ten Commandments law. So that's what he's talking about here, is the Ten Commandments. So it's through a knowledge of the Ten Commandments, we know what sin is. Sin is the breaking of the Ten Commandments. That's what it says. Now, let me make something very clear. It's not speaking of only outward actions at all, not at all. Because before we ever do anything, we've already thought about it, haven't we? It's a sin to think about the wrong thing. That's breaking the law too, friends. And when we devise sin in our minds, that's just as much sin as stepping out and doing it. So I'm not speaking only of outward actions. I'm speaking about the breaking of God's law in thought, word, and deed, and all the way through. Now in Romans chapter 3 and verse 20, Paul here again focuses on sin and he speaks about the law. He says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. So I need the law to know what sin is, because the law tells me what sin is. But if sin is a broken relationship, I don't need the law to know what sin is. Right? Now, I'm just going to give a couple quotations. We're making this almost always a Bible-based message today. But just so you can understand that I'm not alone in this, I just want to give you a couple quotations. In Signs of the Times, January 8, 1894, Ellen White wrote this. The only definition given in the Word of God as to what is sin is found in 1 John 3, 4, and then she quotes it, whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. The testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy, says that this is the only definition given in the Word of God. Now, she's very wise. I like the way she writes this. She doesn't say it's the only definition of sin, because other people define sin in different ways. But it doesn't make it a biblical definition. She says the only definition given in the Word of God. In another statement, in Review and Herald of April 3, 1888, good date, She says, now we want to understand what sin is, that it is the transgression of God's law. This is the only definition given in the scriptures. And I'll just give you one more. And I could give you about 30, but I'm just going to give you one more, okay? Our only definition of sin is that given in the Word of God. It is the transgression of the law. It is the outworking of a principle at war with the great law of love, which is the foundation of the divine government. And of course, that's from a book you're all familiar with, The Great Controversy, page 492. Now, Dr. Ghaly earlier said that sin is separation from God. But the Bible says that sin is the transgression of the law of God. So let's see how this all fits together with this idea of being separated from God. And we turn to Isaiah 59, verse 2. Isaiah 59, verse 2. It says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. He says, your iniquities, and iniquity is a synonym for sin. If you don't believe it, I'm going to prove it. Okay? We're going to go step by step, line by line, precept upon precept. But he says your iniquities or your sins have separated between you and your God. So the sin is what brings separation. Ghaly says you have separation and that brings sin. The Bible says you have sin and that brings separation. You see how he has it reversed 180 degrees. Yes. It seems logical, it seems plausible, but it's not biblical. And it leads ultimately to a lot of problems. And Satan is quite well pleased with this kind of a definition, I assure you. Now, the word iniquity here in the Hebrew is awan. And it's a parallel with sin. And I'm going to show you some verses that teach us that this concept of what we call iniquity here from the Hebrew is also the same thing as sin. Just another synonym for it. In Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 5. He says, and cover not their iniquities, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. Now, in the Hebrew mind, in the Hebrew economy, Hebrew language, you have a concept used a lot in writing called parallelism. Parallelism. A thought is said, and then another similar thought is said, but using maybe different words. And notice he says, cover not their iniquities, and let not their sin be blotted out. Okay, the removal of sin was considered a blotting out of sin. The blood would blot over the record and cover it up. And covering, in fact, the Hebrew word atonement is from a word kafar, which means to cover. Okay, but it's clearly a parallel passage here. That was Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 5. Okay, now let's go to Psalms. We'll look at a couple in Psalms. We can find Psalms 32 first. Psalms 32 and verse 1. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is what? Covered. Again, sin, iniquity, their transgressions, these concepts are the same. Now, the reason I bring this one in, and keep your hand here in Psalms, because we're going to turn right back to it. But if you turn over with me to the book of Romans, chapter 4 and verse 7, Paul here is quoting from Psalms 32:1, and it says, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. So you have one translation using the expression iniquities, another transgressions, sins. All these are the same thing. Okay? They're all the same thing. Let's go back to Psalms. Psalms 38 and verse 18. Psalms 38, 18. David says, for I will declare mine iniquity, I will be sorry for my sin. Do you see how these statements are parallel? One says sin, the other says iniquity. One line says that. So they're clearly parallel. And we could look at other verses. I'll just give you a couple other quick verses if you want to make a note of them. Psalms 85, verse 2. Psalms 85, verse 2. Job 10, verse 6. Just to give you a couple more. But now let's go back to Romans 7. In Romans 7, 12, it says, wherefore the law is holy and the commandment holy and just and good. The Greek word that we translate law is nomos. Nomos. And this word means law. Now, we're speaking about things that are antithesis to the law. Sin, iniquity, transgression, unrighteousness. These are all antithesis to law. They're antithesis to righteousness. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14, I want you to notice another word. 2 Corinthians 6:14. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath, what's the word?
Righteousness.
Righteousness with what? unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? Now in English, to get unrighteousness, you just take the word righteousness and you put an un in front of it, right? But that's not exactly what they did, because there's a different word for righteous and a different word for unrighteousness here. Okay? The word for unrighteousness is anomia. Anomia. And what it is, it's basically the Greek word for law with a letter A in front of it. In the Greek, we call it an alpha. And one of the rules of Greek writing and grammar is very simple, that if you have a word and you want to change its meaning to the opposite of that word, all you have to do is put an A in front of it, or the alpha in front of it, and it makes it the opposite meaning. So the meaning of unrighteousness, the meaning of iniquity, is the opposite of the law. But sin, hamartia, is the transgression of the law. It is the anomia of the law. In 1 John 3:4, when he says sin is the transgression of the law, he's saying sin is against the law. That's what sin is. That's why we say sin is the transgression of the law, because sin is against the law. Sin is what we do to break the law of God. And this is also true in Hebrews 1:9. Hebrews 1:9. We find this same word used here for iniquity, anomia. Anomia. It's from nomos, but depending on the variation of how it's used, remember that Greek is an inflected language, like Latin. Hebrews 1:9. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated what? Iniquity. But that word iniquity is anomia. Thou hast hated that which is against the law of God. That's what iniquity is. Therefore, God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness, which is above thy fellows. Now, I want to ask a question. Because we saw that sin is not a broken relationship. Sin leads to a broken relationship, right? Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. But there's another idea that's very popular about sin. And that is that sin is our nature. Sin is our nature. That we are sinners by nature. I think Golly used the term that we were born sinners. So I want you to turn with me to Psalms 51 and verse 5. Psalms 51 verse 5. And we're going to talk a little bit about this verse today. And we're going to try to find out what the verse could say. And we're going to find out what the verse does not say. Psalms 51 verse 5 says, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." You might find it interesting that this word shapen from the Hebrew is the exact same form of a word that is translated in Proverbs chapter 8, verses 24 and 25 as brought forth. In Proverbs 8, remember where it says, wisdom says, I was brought forth, but that word literally means begotten. And so in Psalms 51 and verse 5 here, when he says, I was shapen in iniquity, he means I was begotten or born in iniquity. The question is, what does that mean? What does that mean? Now, I'm going to go back and quote Dr. Golly for just a minute, because I want you to understand what the contemporary teachings are. In his first book of his systematic theology, again, on page 157, he says, "Scripture penetrates beyond the thoughts, motives, and feelings that lie behind outward acts of sin to a tendency to sin that is inherent in fallen human nature." Now, if I just stop right there, we probably could agree with most of that. That we have within us, because of our heredity, a tendency to do wrong. But notice he goes on. David spoke of this when he said he was, quote, "sinful from the time my mother conceived me." Now, he doesn't state it, but I put in brackets here. He's quoting from the New International Version, because that's not what the King James says. Okay, just so you know. Note that he, referring to David, not Golly's writing, he says, note that he says that he was not just sinful from birth, but from conception. Okay. Now, Golly goes on to quote from the commentary of the Old Testament by Kyle and Dillicht. And because I have that book, I'm going to go and just quote from it direct. But what I'm going to quote to you now is quoted in Golly's book right after what we just read. So this is an exact quote in Golly's book, but it's also in this commentary by Kyle and Dillicht. It says, David here confesses his hereditary sin. Now notice it doesn't say a hereditary nature or tendency to sin, but his hereditary sin as the root of his actual sin. The declaration moves backwards from his birth to conception and consequently penetrates even to the most remote points of life's beginning. Now I ask you a question. If this is true, seems logical, might seem reasonable, but if it's true, what does it tell us or what does it imply about the birth of Jesus Christ? It implies that Jesus had to be something different than I am. Because if I'm born a sinner and Jesus took humanity, well, he couldn't have taken humanity like I have. And this is why the Catholic Church has a doctrine called the Immaculate Conception. The doctrine of the Immaculate Conception does not speak about the way Jesus himself was born. It speaks about the way his mother Mary was born. That for Mary to be pure and passed on to Jesus, only a pure, holy nature such that there was no tendency to sin in, she had to be born without any hereditary tendencies to sin, and therefore her conception was miraculous, or the Immaculate Conception. But it tells me that Jesus had to be very different than me, and he didn't share our nature. Now, Gali's not the only one who's teaching this. In the August 2018 issue of the magazine Open Face, when the Bible speaks that Adam's sin made us sinners, it's not speaking of guilt, it is speaking of nature. All Adam's descendants became sinners by nature. They became a kind of being called sinners. And whether or not we are guilty, the fact is that all sinners are unfit to live. No sinner can inherit eternal life. Well, I guess Jesus was born a sinner and he's not fit to have eternal life, or he's not fit to be a savior. But he's making some suppositions here. And if we have time, I'm going to show you later why he makes this supposition and why it's wrong. But this is what is being taught. Now, we should not fail to mention Augustine. Sometimes they call him Augustine. And he was a professed Christian who lived back in the 4th century into the 5th century. He was one of those ancient Catholic Church fathers. And Augustine struggled with the sin of unrighteous sexual desires. And he never seemed to find a victory over his problem. And so his only solution was to change his theology to fit his problem. He came to the conclusion that man was helpless, even under the power of Christ, to overcome sin due to a weakened nature he received from Adam. This included not only a weakened nature, but the guilt and the condemnation of Adam as well. And by defining sin to include the nature we were born with, Augustine concluded that we are born sinners. This suggestion that man is born a sinner leads directly again to the Roman Catholic doctrine of the Immaculate Conception and also to infant baptism. Because after all, if the child is born a sinner and possibly it might die or, you know, gets disease, and that happened a lot back in those days, right? Children didn't live very long. The ones who made it, but not many made it. And so that's why they had to have infant baptism to try to wash away the filth of original sin. That's what they called original sin. Now, to better understand this text we're looking at in Psalms 51:5, I want to look at two concepts which theologically are called exegesis and eisegesis, or sometimes called eisegesis. These words describe concepts that are really not difficult to grasp. Exegesis means literally to lead out. It is a critical explanation or interpretation of a text, particularly a religious text. Traditionally, the term was used primarily for the work of the Bible. Sometimes people use it in common vernacular today. But it starts with a prefix, ek. And it's from two different words. Here you see it is. It's from the word Greek word ek, which means out of, and then the word for to guide or to lead. It means to lead out or to bring out. To bring out of the text. And that's a very important point. Now, eisegesis or eisegesis is the process of interpreting a text or portion of a text in such a way that the process includes one's own presuppositions, agendas, or biases into and onto the text. This is commonly referred to as reading into the text. The act is often used to prove a pre-held point of concern to the reader and to provide him or her with confirmation bias in accordance with his or her pre-held agenda. Eisegesis is best known when contrasted with exegesis. As an example, in Revelation chapter 1, verse 10, John says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. That's what the text says. If we take this process of eisegesis or eisegesing the text, I can put my own idea into it and say, well, he was in the Spirit on Sunday because Sunday's the Lord's day. And that would be the way most people today interpret that text. But is it what the text itself says? No, the text doesn't say that at all. But does the Bible say anything else about the Lord having a special day somewhere else?
Yes.
Well, sure. Isaiah 58:13. He calls the Sabbath my holy day. Mark chapter 2, verses 27, 28. Jesus calls himself the Lord of the Sabbath day. And so we can understand that the Lord's day, John's speaking about, is the seventh day Sabbath through exegesis. But if we use eisegesis for most people, it just means Sunday. So now what we're going to do, we're going to look at Psalms 51, verse 5, and we're going to go through here about 14 different steps. And it's not going to take long because I've got them on a chart for you here, and I hope you can see them. Here's a comparison of exegesis and eisegesis. We have some questions and we have answers based upon either we're looking strictly at the text or putting our own ideas into the text, okay? So number one, who is speaking? According to the text, who is speaking? He says, I was shapen in iniquity.
David.
But what do most people think and interpret it to mean? All humanity. David says, I was shapen in iniquity, but we translate that into saying that everyone was shapen in iniquity. Now, maybe we were, but that's not what the text says. I'm just looking at what the text says versus what it doesn't say. Is that fair? Point number two, whom is he talking about? Well, the text, clearly he's talking about himself and his mother. But the answer by eisegesis is that all mothers and all humanity, in other words, we're putting into the text everyone. David's speaking about himself, but we're going to put everyone into this text. Number three, what act is he talking about? Clearly, he's talking about his conception, even his birth and conception, no question about that. The answer by eisegesis, the conception of all humanity. Are you seeing that there's a difference between these two thoughts, how we interpret the text? And could these possibly lead to two different variations of final interpretation? They surely will. Question number four, what does he say about it? In the Bible, he says it was done in sin. He is correct on that. But the answer by eisegesis, well, it's always done in sin. It's us, it's all humanity, it's me, it's all my mother, all of our mothers, and it was always done in sin. And by the way, some people have taken this to the extreme to say that any kind of sexual relation is a sin, even those that procreate children. Whose sin was it? Answer by exegesis, his mother's sin. Answer by eisegesis, all mothers. Question six, what was its nature? According to exegesis, the text, it doesn't tell us, does it? It doesn't say what the nature of that sin was. But according to eisegesis, we say it's original sin and guilt. That's what we say. Going to the next slide. What are the possibilities? Well, exegesis says his mother may have committed adultery. Maybe she was a concubine. Maybe she was just an evil mother. Or maybe it does mean the condition of the whole race. Those are possibilities that could be brought forth based upon the text. By eisegesis, the answer is it's original sin and guilt, and always that. Number eight, who was his mother? Does the text tell us? No, but who do we assume it is? We assume it's the wife of Jesse. We assume that by eisegesis. Was she Jesse's lawful wife? Does the text tell you?
No.
Doesn't tell you. In fact, the Bible doesn't tell you about his mother. Not here or other places. But eisegesis says, oh yes, that had to be his mother. Because it represents all mothers. Was she a concubine? Text doesn't say. Eisegesis, oh no, she couldn't have been a concubine. She had to be Jesse's lawful wife. Next slide. Was she an adulteress? We don't know. Text doesn't say. Eisegesis? She couldn't have been an adulteress. No way. Number 12. Was her union with Jesse lawful? Number 12. Well, according to exegesis, we don't know. Again, we're just seeing what we can bring out of the text without putting our ideas into it. But most people will tell you, yes, she had to be the lawful wife of Jesse. 13. What conclusions may we reach? Any answer from number 7 is possible. So if we go, and I'll show you all of them again here, summarized quickly. But that means everything in the exegesis column is possible. Number 13, in eisegesis, the doctrine of original sin and guilt. That's what it means. Number 14, how do we compare these two, the exegesis and the eisegesis? Number 14, in the exegesis column, every statement is a fact. They're all facts. Now, we may not know some of those things, but when we say we don't know, that's a fact that we don't know. In the exegesis, number 14, every statement above is an assumption. Now, they're a little hard to read because I put them all here in one chart. But this is the whole chart that you just saw, that you have saw in three stages, all in just one. But everything that exegesis says, 1 through 13, is a fact. Everything 1 through 13 in the exegesis is an assumption. Is an assumption. And friends, we never base a biblical doctrine on an assumption.
Amen.
And I just added one more point of thought. When Samuel came to anoint David, you remember that David had these other brothers? And they were home. But where was David?
Seven.
He was out watching the sheep. Wonder why he was segregated from the others. Maybe there was a reason. Not simply just because he was the youngest. Anyhow. Now, this is part of something that's very important for us to understand, because we as Adventist people, we were called out by God to bring a death knell to the papacy. We were called out to say, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. We were called out to teach people that there's one true God and one mediator between God and man Christ Jesus. We were called out to contradict the concept of the Mass, that this sacrifice can continue over and over. We were called out to trumpet the truth about the Seventh-day Sabbath and not to allow people to continue to break God's holy law through ignorance. We were called out to bring forth the true Protestant principles of the Bible against the man of sin. Now, in 1899, around that time, going back a little in history, in the state of Indiana, there was a conference of Seventh-day Adventists in the state of Indiana. It was just called the Indiana Conference. And there arose a teaching called the Holy Flesh Doctrine. The Holy Flesh Doctrine. And this teaching taught basically that you are a sinner by nature, you are born a sinner, and God's going to translate a special people, but before he can translate them, he has to give them a new nature, and he has to change their flesh from sinful flesh to holy flesh. Now this teaching was met head on by Ellen White and the leaders of the church, and they showed it was very false, they showed it was wrong, and why it was wrong. And at least supposedly at that time, those people who had been involved in that repented and confessed their error and started to teach differently. But in 1901, they had a general conference session, and E.J. Wagoner was there preaching. And he's preaching about the incarnation of Christ. And I'm going to read just a few slides of something he said. Now, Wagoner was one of those great preachers of the church back in the 1888 times, if you are familiar with that. He says, some of you possibly have supposed in hearing of it that it meant that Jesus was born sinless. Now, what doctrine do you think he's talking about? The Immaculate Conception. And we talked about it a minute ago, too. But Wagoner also concurs with what we said. That is not the Catholic dogma at all. The doctrine of the Immaculate Conception is that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was born sinless. Why? Ostensibly to magnify Jesus, really the work of the devil, to put a wide gulf between Jesus, the Savior of men, and the men whom he came to save, so that one could not pass over to the other. That is all. So he says that this concept of an Immaculate Conception, or anything related to it, its goal is really to put a gulf between Christ and human beings so that one can't cross over to the other. He goes on. And he asks a penetrating question, and I tell you, it's a question I want to ask us today, and I want to ask everyone who's listening to this video today. We need to settle, every one of us, whether we are out of the Church of Rome or not. You know, we think we may be out of the Church of Rome, but friends, if we're teaching doctrines like sin, on sin, like the Church of Rome is teaching, we're not out of Rome yet.
Amen.
And in fact, because of this teaching, it's become much easier for people to head back toward Rome, mm-hmm. and even to the point of saying, well, you know, I'm not sure that the Catholic Church is the beast anymore, and Sunday is not the mark of the beast anymore. Friends, one thing just piles on and tipples over to the other. Reigner says, we need to settle, every one of us, whether we are out of the Church of Rome or not. There are a great many that have gotten the marks yet, but I am persuaded of this, that every soul who is here tonight desires to know the way of truth and righteousness. And the congregation all said amen. And that there is no one here who is unconsciously clinging to the dogmas of the papacy who does not desire to be free from them. And I'd like to say today that I think there are people who are holding on to certain doctrines of the papacy today. And I don't think that they're wanting to do this. They don't understand that they're doing this. But it's time that they become enlightened and understand. Wagner goes on. Do you not see the idea that the flesh of Jesus was not like ours because we know ours is sinful? Necessarily involves the idea of the Immaculate Conception of the Virgin Mary. Mind you, in him was no sin, but the mystery of God manifest in the flesh, the marvel of ages, the wonder of the angels, the thing which even now they desire to understand and which they can form no just idea of, only as they are taught it by the Church, is the perfect manifestation of the life of God in its spotless purity in the midst of sinful flesh. Congregation says amen. Oh, that is a marvel, is it not? So Wagner says Christ came in sinful flesh. What he means by that is that he came with a flesh that has the tendencies, the pull to do wrong, but he never did wrong. So look here, if sin is our nature, and if Christ had that same tendency to sin that we have, and if that for us is sin, it must have been sin for him. And then he, friends, can't be our Savior because he's a sinner too. So God does not account the sinful nature as sin toward us. It's a deficiency for sure, but it's nothing that can't be overcome by the new birth experience, by having Christ live in us. Amen. Now I want to look at some texts as we continue. If anyone's getting tired, just let me know. We'll take a break, but we're not stopping. Make no apologies. Romans chapter 14. Because I have people tell me, well, you know, your idea of 1 John 3:4 being the only Bible definition of sin is a little narrow. There are other Bible definitions of sin. Now, that might sound good if you didn't know the Bible well, and it might sound really good if you didn't know Ellen White's writings. But when you read her writings and she says this is the only definition of sin, the only definition the Bible gives us, and so on and so forth, I can kind of believe that. I think it makes a lot of sense. Romans chapter 14 and verse 23. It says, and he that doubteth is damned if he eat. He's speaking about eating foods and different things. But it goes on to say, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Do you see that? The last part of Romans 14, 23. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Is that also a definition of sin? No, it's not. It's explaining something that sin is. And let me explain how that works very simply. Is there any way that you can obey God's law by yourself? The Bible says that as we receive the Lord Jesus, so we are to walk in him. How did you receive Jesus? By grace through faith. How do you walk with Jesus? By grace through faith. Friends, without faith, you are destined to break God's law. Whatsoever is not of faith must be sin, because without faith, you can't keep God's law. Very simple. Not hard to understand at all. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. It says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men. I'm going to stop right there. If I stop right there, it seems to imply that death upon all men and all that we have today is because of one man's sin. That's the sin of Adam. But does the verse stop there? What does the verse say right after that? I mean, what's the rest of the verse?
For that all sin.
Now, what does that word for mean? What would be a synonym for it here?
Because.
This has happened because we've all sinned. And the wages of sin is what?
Death.
Romans 6:23. Romans 5:19. And this was a text that was made reference to earlier today, and I want to look at it again. Romans 5:19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Now, is there a difference between many and all?
Yes.
Yes, there is, isn't there? Many comes from the Greek word poly. I mentioned this to you earlier. You know, polygram, polyglot, you know, poly means many. But in the Greek, there's a word for all, and it's pos, and that's not the word used here. Now, there's clearly a parallel structure here to Paul's theology in verse 19. He says, one man's disobedience made many sinners. One man's obedience made many righteous. Let's just say that we put in the word all in the place of many. Let's just do that. We can do that. And just see if it makes sense if we do that. For by one man's disobedience, all were made sinners, so by the obedience of one, all will be made righteous. If I'm going to follow the parallel structure and say all people become sinners because of the disobedience of Adam, I must also say that all people become righteous by the mediation of Christ. But I ask you a question, is everyone going to be saved?
No.
No, there's going to be some pretty wicked people who are going to be lost. And not everyone's going to be saved. So what Paul is speaking about here cannot be an organic relationship. When I say an organic relationship, it's not a relationship based upon DNA. It's a relationship based upon who you follow and the pattern, the way you follow them. Many people have become sinners because they have followed after the way of Adam. But many people will become righteous because they follow after the pattern and the way of Jesus Christ. It's not speaking of an organic relationship. Now, I mentioned to you that I would come back to this concept a little bit more. In this open face that we were recording earlier on, and I believe it's on even page one, it says, he's referring to Romans 5:19. He says in verse 19, it says, by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners. Do these verses tell the truth? How could we all become sinners because of one man's disobedience? But he says that we all became sinners by his disobedience. He's going to try to explain how. But notice, this is not what the text says. You know, the text says many. It doesn't say all and it doesn't say how. But he's interpreting it as an organic relationship and that it applies to every individual who's ever lived. But that's not what the text says. But you see how we can take, and we just ask the question, do these verses tell the truth? Well, of course, everyone's going to say the Bible tells the truth. Every verse tells the truth. But then he interprets that verse and you're supposed to think, well, that's truth. And it looks good. It may seem logical at first if you don't read carefully. You've got to read carefully. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Now, friends, if sin was our nature, what would be the very point of him stating verse 1? Unless we can get holy flesh or some kind of new nature, new flesh that changes everything. You know, it doesn't make sense. It just couldn't make sense unless he's speaking about sin being the transgression of the law. Verses 16 and 18, let's look at those verses. He says in verse 16, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Notice again, he's running a parallel thought, but this time it's a contrasting parallel thought. You have sin which leads to disobedience, you have obedience, he says you have sin which leads to death and obedience to righteousness. But what is obedience? Obedience to what? To the law of God. To the law of God. Verse 18. Being then made free from sin, ye became servants of righteousness. I mean, if the Bible just can speak for itself, it will do a good job. Now, I'm just going to interject something here because some people may have a question based upon some things they've read in Ellen White's writings. Does she not speak about having a new nature when we are converted? Well, she speaks both about an old nature and a new nature. But what does she mean by this? Does it mean that the old nature is never there again and is replenished with a new nature, which would result in new and holy flesh? I want to just give you about three or four statements here, just so you have them for your reference. Here's a statement. This is in Christ Object Lessons. I chose this one because it's such a universal reference. You can find it, but there are similar references in other places. The Spirit works upon man's heart according to his desire and consent, implanting in him a new nature, but the class represented by the fully virgins have been content with a superficial work. Now here she speaks about implanting in man, not replacing, not taking out, but implanting in man a new nature. Notice this statement now from Councils on Health. Begotten again into a lively hope, imbued with the quickening power of a new nature, the soul is enabled to rise higher and still higher. Here she uses the term imbued. She used the term implanting, now imbued. And I think she used this terminology much like she used the following phraseology. In Medical Ministry on page 181, speaking about Jesus, he took upon his sinless nature. He came from heaven with a sinless nature, right? He took upon his sinless nature, our sinful nature, that he might know how to succor, to help those that are tempted. Now, I'm going to show you a statement. And this statement is from a manuscript 28, 1897. And it has a section where there are some greater than and less than symbols. And what these mean is that the author had written this manuscript prior and then came back and looked at it and inserted these words inner line or in the line, like between the lines or between the words, because it more clearly expressed what they wanted to say or added something to it. But it says, if all could understand the deep trials and discouragements that came to the human nature of Christ in his mission and work, very verily human hearts would draw nigh to the human heart of Jesus. In the disciples, their old nature would often appear. And did you get that? Their old nature would often appear, but Jesus was ever presenting before them that and she originally wrote that the powers of the human heart, but then she said the natural powers of the human heart, which were striving for the mastery, must be given up, emptied from the soul, that he might implant a new nature therein. But notice what she puts there beside implant a new nature. She puts a new principle. In other words, in her mind, the having of a new nature was implanting a new principle into the work of how you think and understand things. It is essential to live by every word of God, else the old nature will reassert itself. So the old nature is never taken away. It's still there. But now we have a new principle implanted by the Holy Spirit of God that empowers us. And by the way, love is a high and holy what?
Principle.
Okay. So there's nothing derogatory here about calling this a new principle. And we need this new principle in our lives to overcome the old. The bottom line is found in 1 Corinthians 15:31. 1 Corinthians 15:31. He says, I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord. And those last three words. 1 Corinthians 15:31. Everybody turn there with me. I want you to see it. Last three words, especially. That's right. Whoa, 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 whoa. I thought I came to Christ. The struggle's over. You ever hear that? In fact, I read an article one time, the struggle is over. But that's not what the scripture is. It's not what Paul said. Paul said, I die daily. He realized that that old man, as sometimes he referred to it in Romans, that old man was always there, always ready to be resurrected and to take hold. But if we have Christ in our lives, friends, continually, every moment, then the old man will never take reign again, never needs to take reign again. Excuse me. Now, I should just cover a couple more points before we quit. And by my definition of a couple, I'm not sure how many that means. It depends on how we subcategorize them all. But is temptation sin? I ask you a very simple question. Is temptation sin? It's not a sin to be tempted then, we understand. Was Jesus ever tempted?
Yes.
He was tempted more than anyone else ever. Let's turn to James chapter 1. James is near the end of the Bible, just after Hebrews, before Peter and John's epistles. James chapter 1, we'll read verses 13 through 15. And I'm going to show you another reason why you have to be very, very careful if you're using other translations. It says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. So, let me just give you another translation of this. And I want you to tell me if this looks similar, but yet maybe somewhat different than what we just read. This is from the NIV. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desire, he is dragged away and enticed. Then, after desire he has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Is that a little different? I put three words in red, hoping to give you a hint. Is that what it says in the King James Bible? Here in the NIV it says his own evil desire. In the King James Bible, it speaks of his own lust. Now sometimes in our English vernacular today, we think of the term lust as always being something negative. But this is actually from a Greek word. It's epithymia, and it means simply a desire, a passionate longing for. And I'm going to show you a couple other places it's used. In Luke chapter 22, okay? Luke chapter 22 and verse 15. And he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Who's speaking?
Jesus.
Did Jesus sin?
No.
Did he have bad thoughts? No. No. The devil tempted him with things, of course. But Jesus never acted upon any of those temptations. But here he says, with desire I have desired. He's saying, I've lusted in the Greek. Because it's the same word that's translated in James 1:14, lust. It's just simply a desire. The word itself does not carry the connotation of good or evil. Because we can have good desires and we can have bad desires. You may as well just use the English word desire here. Because that's what it really means. Another place is found in Philippians 1:23. I know this is a text that sometimes we struggle with. It's a good text. But Paul says, for I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. That word desire is the same word that's translated lust in James. So it just simply means a passion, a longing, a desire.
What was that text again?
Philippians 1:23. But there are other verses. I'm just giving you two as an example. And sometimes it does have the connotation of wrong things. There are verses it does. But I'm just saying the word itself isn't an indicator of whether you should translate it as an evil desire or just, you know, whatever it is. That might indeed fit in many respects in James, but it's not what the text says. That's what I'm telling you. Now, in 1889, we published a statement of fundamental beliefs, and some of you have seen that and read it, and it's very similar to the one of 1872, just a little different. But there was a statement, number 20, I want to read to you, and I want you to notice what it says. That God, in accordance with his uniform dealings with the race, sends forth a proclamation of the approach of the second advent of Christ, and that this work is symbolized by the three messages of Revelation 14, the last one bringing to view the work of reform on the law of God, that his people may acquire a complete readiness for that event. Has it been part of our fundamental teaching in the past that there is a work of reform on the law of God in the three angels' messages? And especially in the third angel's message? Absolutely. Absolutely. Our pioneers understood what sin was. And they understood the need for reform on this matter. Now, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 3. That's just a little past where we were at. He says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed. He is called the son of perdition. He's the son of death, the son of destruction. He's the son of perdition. He's the son of the devil. And he's called the man of sin. Verse 8. Then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. He's called in verse 7 the mystery of iniquity. Why is he called the man of sin? Why is he called the mystery of iniquity, friends? In fact, in verse 8 here, when it says, then shall that wicked, that the word wicked here is from the Greek word anomios. It's that word that we translate iniquity. It's the word that's the law of God with the prefix that turns its meaning to be 180 degrees. He is called the man of sin, friends, because he has changed, or he has tried to change, the times and laws of God. And that is why he is called the man of sin. He has changed the definition of sin. And he has changed the law of God. Now, I want to just bring out a couple points that I think are necessary. And we'll be closing with these points. The Bible says that sin is a terrible thing, and the law of God is a holy thing. And sometimes we fail, I think, sometimes to understand truly just how exalted and how high the law of God is and how far we have fallen. And let it be remembered, friends, that inside the most holiest building ever upon this earth the sanctuary structure, inside the most holy place, the holiest room in the holiest building, was the holiest piece of furniture, which was the Ark of the Covenant. And inside that Ark was the Ten Commandments written with the very finger of God. Friends, the law of God is high, it is holy, it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of heart of man. And no one should do anything to denigrate or belittle the law of God or say that it doesn't fully explain sin. But there is a concept that's taught in Calvinism. It's called total depravity. The total depravity of man is a doctrine from Calvin and others, and it teaches that man is so depraved by original sin that he cannot do good. He has zero ability to seek God or know Him. Thus, for a man to be saved, he must be predestined by God for salvation, and God supplies to this person preventing grace so that he will be able to repent and follow God. Thus, in Adam all die, this is one of the main points of Calvinism. Now, Calvinism today is often summarized by the acrostic TULIP. TULIP. The T stands for total depravity. They believe in total depravity. They believe in unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and perseverance of the saints. What does this mean? Total depravity. Again, it means that no one can accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior unless God helps them to do it, because they have no ability of their own to do it. And only after God makes a person alive can he and will he accept Christ. No man can come unto me except the Father which has sent me draw him. John 6:44 will be quoted. And so accepting Christ is a work done after becoming a Christian. Did you get that? You only accept Christ after you've become a Christian. Because God makes you a Christian, then you can accept Christ. Because before that, you don't even have the ability to do that. Unconditional election. That means it's not my choice. It's not my choice. Those of us who watched the video of Torture for Christ the other night, I don't know if you caught it, but Richard Wurmbrand made a statement which indicated very clearly this was his philosophy. And he said, I don't know why God chose me to be one of the elect because I was just such a simple person. But that was his statement. You know, well, why would God choose me? But he, you know, in his sovereign will and grace and understanding, he did. So God makes the choices. Of course, when he chooses some to be saved, he also chooses some to be lost. A limited atonement. Again, the atonement doesn't cover everybody. When Jesus says, whosoever will, let him drink of the water of life freely, well, there's only so many who will. Yeah, that's right. They'll say that's right, but there's only so many who will. Irresistible grace. You can be dragged kicking and screaming to heaven, and you're going to go whether you like it or not. That's what it means. You'll go whether you like it or not. Perseverance of the saints, preservation of the saints, that means once saved, always saved, basically. In other words, once God saves you, there's no going back. So, this is really not sensible, friends. But there's one part of it that does have some sense, and it's the very first part, the total depravity. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. And there is, in a limited sense, a total depravity that we all are born with, that we need help with. So how does this then work out? Well, John Wesley, who was a pretty smart guy in a lot of things, he made a couple statements I just want to share with you. And then I want to talk to you about a concept that some of the reformers believed in. He says, no man living is without some preventing grace. Now, I mentioned this term preventing grace a little bit ago when I was talking about total depravity and Calvinism. Preventing grace was a term that was used by some of the reformers, and let me explain that the word preventing here means preceding in our English today. If you remember in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, when it says that we will not prevent those which are asleep, it means we will not proceed or go ahead. The old English word prevent meant to go before, to proceed. Today, we hold it as basically just having the meaning of holding back, but that wasn't what it meant at that time. And they said that God has a grace. These reformers, like Wesley, they were saying that God has a grace that goes before. This preceding grace. And every degree of grace is a degree of life. In another place, I assert that there is a measure of free will supernaturally restored to every man, together with that supernatural light which enlightens every man that cometh into the world. So what Wesley was saying, and several reformers agreed with this, was that God understands that man is helpless, And so what he does, he supplies enough grace to everybody. Not to just an elect few, not just to a limited atonement, but to every individual. And this is why Jesus has done something very substantial for everyone who's ever lived, even if they don't accept him. He has given them the grace where they can accept him, where they can make a choice, where they can say, you know, I do want to serve this guy. I don't have the power to do it, but I want to do it. And once we cry out, of course, God supplies the help for us. There was a reformer by the name of Jacob Arminius. And he became quite well known for this concept. And he believed in this concept of free will, that we each could have a choice, that God would enable us to make a choice, as opposed to Calvin, who said that you're either predestined to be saved or lost, and you don't have any choice in the matter whatever. But the doctrine of sin is a foundational doctrine in Christianity, friends. So much is built upon it. And if we don't get it right, then we're not going to have a lot else correct. And some of these reformers understood what sin was, and some of them didn't. And that was basically the dividing line between, for instance, those who followed Arminians and those who followed Calvin, was their understanding of what sin was and how they played that out. If we don't have the idea of sin correct, then we're going to have a different Christ, a Christ who could not come as we are to redeem us from where we are at. We could not have a choice in the matter of our salvation if it wasn't for preventing or preceding grace, the grace of Jesus. And even then, we must remember that nothing can be done without Christ. All that Adam did to humanity, which would have been forced upon each child in the generations to come, has been taken back by Christ so that every person can be saved. In John chapter 3, Jesus said in verse 3, speaking to Nicodemus, his first words to Nicodemus were, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Friends, without the new birth, the regeneration, we can't see the kingdom of God. And then you come down, Jesus says, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." Now, if you look at that and contrast it slightly with verse 3, in verse 3, he says, "I say unto thee." Thee is first person, singular. But now he says, "I say unto ye." I say this unto thee, ye must be born again. But ye is second person plural in Old English, right? And the Greek is second person plural. In other words, when he's saying you here, and this is the problem when you get into some of the newer translations, because if you read the NIV, NASB, any of the newer translations, in verse 7, Jesus is going to say, "Marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again." But that's not what the text says. The text says, ye. Plural. In other words, you all of you, in West Virginia we would say you all, or maybe you-ins, all of you, all you Jewish people, everybody who's on this earth must be born again if you're going to be saved. And he makes provision for that through Christ for us. But friends, this whole issue is foundational. It's foundational to who Jesus is to us. It's foundational to what we're going to overcome, what we believe we must overcome, the battles, what we're going to fight. It's going to build so much else on our theology, and I could just tell you story after story, but I know our time is well past. But one of the reasons that I bring this out is that sooner or later, and probably sooner, you're going to see more and more of this kind of theology taught, and it's even being taught among people who claim to believe the truth about God. But friends, I'm just content to stay with what the Bible says very plainly. I'm content to stay with the faith of our pioneers. I'm content to stay with the faith of those early Protestant reformers that understood these things because they were understanding them from the Bible. You know, it's not enough just to go along with something because the reformers believed it. It's not enough just to go along with something because even Ellen White believed it. But what does the Bible say? But I think they're all in agreement. I don't think there's any problem whatsoever. And if we will take these verses and look at them carefully, exegetically, not eisegetically, exegetically, then we'll know what the truth is. And Jesus says, "You'll know the truth, and the truth will what?
Make you free."